Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to Redeemer Lutheran Church. We're glad that you are able to join us this morning with our online worship. I know it's not quite the way that we would like to worship on a Sunday morning, but given the situation that we're facing right now, this is just the safest way to do it. I know last week was Easter Sunday. It was a joyous day, a day of celebration, but boy, it just felt a little different, didn't it? When we couldn't gather together as God's people here in a church. We weren't able to celebrate and have that wonderful pancake breakfast together or watch the kids outside with their Easter egg hunt. But we know that no matter where we are or whatever circumstances we're going through, God is there with us. He's given us the gift of his son, Jesus, and his grace and his mercy comes to us no matter where we are, no matter whether we're here in a church or listening to a service online at home, whether we're by ourselves or with a few family, whether we're in a nursing home, or in a hospital. Jesus is there with you. And I pray that you truly feel his presence today and know that he loves you. This morning, as we worship, there are a couple things I want to bring to your attention that I hope will make your worship experience just a little more meaningful and impactful for you. First of all, as I've stated over the past couple weeks, we do have the worship bulletin online for you. And I know it's a little bit of a chore to get to it, but it's there for you. And to find it, you just got to go back to the tab for the original face page of the website for Redeemer. And at the top of that screen, there should be a tab that says Worship. Click on that tab, and then a Worship Bulletin tab will click down. Click on there, and you have the Worship Bulletin. We are trying to work on getting it. So on the YouTube feed, you can just click right from the video and be able to pull up the bulletin. But we're not quite there yet technology-wise, but hopefully very soon we'll be able to do that. Also, as we worship this morning, we would love to have your prayers included in our service. So at the bottom of our webpage, there's a button that says Prayer Requests. You can click on there at any time now. Go ahead and fill in a prayer request and send it off. And if technology works and we get it here in time, then we will include that prayer in the worship service. Otherwise, we hand them off to our prayer team to continue to pray for you throughout the week, and then we will include those prayers next week as we gather for worship again. Finally, we do need your support. All the churches are desperate for your support, and I'm not just talking about money, I'm talking about prayer. Pray for those that are serving God's people. Pray for our staff and all of the volunteers who work so hard to make sure the good news of Jesus Christ is continuously shared to people, especially at a time like this. Now, if you can, give a gift that is much needed as well, because there are still expenses that have to be paid. We have staff that are continuing to work, and there are people that we're trying to help through this very difficult situation. And again, at the bottom of our webpage, there's a button that says online giving. You can click on there and you can make your gift right there online. And we just appreciate all that you have done as we've worshiped together in this difficult time. And I pray that you've truly felt God's love and his presence in your life. As we prepare ourselves to worship, would you join me first for a moment of prayer? Lord God, as we gather together this morning, I pray that no matter where your people are, they would feel your presence amongst them. Know that you're there to help them through this very difficult time. Know that you gave your very son, Jesus Christ, to die and to rise again, to pay the price for our sin, so that we can be reconciled back to you. Lord, bless us as we worship this morning. May your word come into our hearts and reassure us of all that you've done for us. And may it so change our lives that we're eager to share that love with the other people that are around us. It's in the name of your son, Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen. Now, would you join me as we sing our first hymn this morning, Awake My Heart with Gladness. Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. As we prepare ourselves to make our confession this morning to God Almighty, would you join me first for a moment of silent prayer and reflection? O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you join me as we read the 148th Psalm together? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens, and you waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created, and he established them forever and ever. He gave a decree, and it shall not pass away. Praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures in all depths, fire and hail, snow and mist, stormy and wind filling his word. Mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, beasts and all livestock, creeping things and all flying birds, kings of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth, young men and maidens together, old men and children. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His majesty is above earth and heaven. He has raised up a horn for his people, praise for all his saints, for the people of Israel who are near to him. Praise the Lord. We continue with the Gloria Patri. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. I turn it over now to our praise band for our next song.
Shake and crumble at your name, the mountains roar and tumble at your name, angels will bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry out, Lord of all the earth. shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. And Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, oh, oh. At your name, the morning breaks glory. At your name, ocean sing your story. And at your name, angels will bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry out. Lord of all the earth, shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. And Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, oh Lord. There is no one like our God, we will praise you, praise you. There's no one like our God, we will sing, we will sing. There is no one like our God, we will praise you, praise you. There's no one like our God, we will sing, we will sing. There is no one like our God, we will praise you, praise you. There's no one like our God, we will stay. Lord of all the earth, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, oh Lord. Oh, 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 oh.
Let us pray. Almighty God, grant that we who have celebrated the Lord's resurrection may by your grace confess in our life and conversation that Jesus is Lord and God. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our first reading on the second Sunday of Easter is taken from the book of Acts, the 5th chapter. But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised Jesus, whom you killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted at his right hand as leader and savior, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." When they heard this, they were enraged and wanted to kill them. But a Pharisee in the council named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law held in honor by all the people, stood up and gave orders to put the men outside for a little while. And he said to them, "Men of Israel, take care what you are about to do with these men. For before these days, Theudas rose up, claiming to be somebody, and a number of men, about 400, joined him. He was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing after him. Judas the Galilean rose up in the days of the census and drew away some of the people after him. He too perished, and all who followed him were scattered. So in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men and let them alone. For if this plan or this understanding is of man, it will fail. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them. You might even be found opposing God. So they took his advice, and when they had called in the apostles, they beat them and charged them not to speak in the name of Jesus, and let them go. Then they left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And every day, in the temple and from house to house, they did not cease teaching and preaching Jesus as the Christ. Our epistle reading is taken from 1 Peter chapter 1. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary. You have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. As we prepare for the gospel, normally we would stand together and we would sing with a loud voice together these words, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. The gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, Peace be with you. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of anyone, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from anyone, it is withheld. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, We have seen the Lord. But he said to them, Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe. 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. Thomas answered him, My Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Once again, I want to turn it over to our praise band, Redeemed, as they lead us in another song, How Great is Your Love.
From the darkness, I called your name. And into darkness, your mercy came. You called me out and lifted me up. How great is your love? You bore my weakness, you took my shame, buried my burdens in fields of grace. You called me out and lifted me up. How great is your love? From the heights of heaven, you stepped down to earth. Innocent perfection, you gave your life for us, and we are amazed, and we stand in awe. Oh, we have been changed by the power of the cross. How great, how great is your love. How great, how great is your love. And how great, how great, how great is your love for us. And in your kindness, you made me whole. And in your presence, where I belong. Oh, you called me out and lifted me up. How great is your love. From the heights of heaven, you stepped down to earth. Innocent perfection, you gave your life for us, and we are amazed, and we stand in awe. For we have been changed by the power of the cross. And how great, how great, how great is your love. How great, how great is your love. How great, how great is your love for us. How great is your love for us. And there's never been, there'll never be a God like you, a love so true. And there's never been, there'll never be a God like you, a love so true. And there's never been, there'll never be God like you, a love so true. There's never been, there'll never be God like you, a love so true. Yeah. How great, how great, how great is your love. How great, how great, how great is your love. And how great, how great, how great is your love for us. And how great, how great is your love. How great, how great, how great is your love. And how great, how great, how great is your love for us. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great, how great is our God.
He is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Over the past month and a half, we've been observing what we call the season of Lent. We've gathered here for worship each week, twice a week, in fact, Sunday mornings and then again on Wednesday evenings. And we've used this time together to look inwardly, to reflect upon our sinfulness and our need for a Savior. Then as this six-week season of Lent came to an end, we entered into what we call Holy Week. We focused on that last week of the life of Jesus. It began on Palm Sunday, and we remembered Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem, how the crowds lined the streets and laid their cloaks and palm leaves on the street and yelled, "Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest." It was a time of celebration. Their king had arrived. The celebration would be short-lived. Monday, Thursday, we saw Jesus gather with his disciples in the upper room to celebrate Passover. And as they were beginning that meal, Jesus demonstrated for them what a servant's heart truly looked like as he washed their feet. And then after they had finished eating, he took bread and wine and he instituted the sacrament of Holy Communion. He said, "This is my body. This is my blood broken and poured out for you for the forgiveness of your sins." But within a few hours, after leaving that upper room and going out to the garden to pray, Jesus would be betrayed by Judas and arrested. Then on Good Friday, we gathered together online and we focused on the last few hours of Jesus' life. We heard how he was beaten, how he was whipped. We remembered how he was placed on a cross up on a hill called Golgotha. There he was nailed to that wood. There Jesus was crucified for us. He received the punishment that we deserve because of our sins. And then Jesus, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, breathed his last and died. It was the darkest moment in Jesus' life. And so we ended our worship service that night in darkness. But then 3 days later, on Easter Sunday, last Sunday, we again logged into our computers and turned on our smartphones, and we gathered together as a virtual church to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We worshiped and we celebrated how Jesus had defeated death and how he had rose from the grave. But with hearts filled with joy and excitement, we proclaimed loudly, "He is risen! He is risen indeed! Hallelujah!" The church, if you remember, last week was decorated. The chancel area was filled with lilies and flowers. Everything looked so festive. But as you look around the church this morning, you see that it doesn't quite look like it did last week. Everything has returned to normal. Jesus has risen, but what's next? All the excitement, all the festivity is over. We're back to business as usual. You know, one of the things that I think we struggle with is being able to keep the momentum of a big day like Easter going. Now, last Sunday, we had so much hope, there was so much life, but today, it feels like last Sunday almost didn't even happen. And why is that? Well, I'll tell you why. It's because we have to still continue living out our lives this side of heaven in a world that is corrupted by sin and temptation. Every day we see the effects of sin and how it has impacted the world that we live in. And because of that, it's so easy to lose sight of Jesus. Think about it. Over the last several months, our minds, our entire lives have been consumed with this coronavirus pandemic. People are getting sick. We see the numbers on our television every single day. People are dying. And in order to stop this spread of this disease, now we have to abide by social distancing rules. People are struggling. You can't go to a restaurant. You can't go to the movies. Schools are closed. Sporting events are canceled. And you can't even gather together with other believers here in church to worship God. No, you're worshiping online right now over a computer or a tablet or a smartphone. And if that's not enough, people are now losing their jobs at an unbelievable rate. They're not able to pay their bills to buy food for their families. The stock market is like a roller coaster up and down. But we still have soldiers, though, that are overseas fighting terrorism. There's still problems around the world. Homeless people are still homeless. Drug addicts are still addicted. Crimes continue to be committed, and the list goes on and on. Our families are falling apart. Morality is at an all-time low, and over and over again, we as a society legalize and support the very things that God forbids. We live in a world infected and completely corrupted by sin. And it's affected every single one of us. It's affected the church as well. My friends, we're suffering. We need Jesus now more than ever. Sure, you feel his presence on a holy day like Easter or Christmas. What about the rest of the year? What about those days when everything is just so ordinary? Those days when we suffer, when we feel the pain of life. Those days when we feel lonely and abandoned. That's when we feel the farthest away from Jesus. So what do? What's next? Well, the answer lies in God's word. You see, when we turn to the Bible reveals to us not only what Jesus did some 2,000 years ago, it reveals to us what he continues to do for us today. Let me explain it like this. You see, our comfort begins by understanding the two natures of Jesus. Jesus is 100% human, and at the same time, he is 100% God. He is truly and fully divine. Now, because Jesus is fully human, we have a God who understands what you're going through. He's not some remote and distant God who can't relate to the problems in your life. No, he has experienced firsthand the same troubles that you're facing. After his baptism, what happened to Jesus? He was taken out into the wilderness and he was tempted by Satan. He knows how conniving and how tricky Satan is. He knows how attractive the devil can make sin look. Jesus felt the pain of losing a friend to death. Lazarus died, and the Bible says Jesus wept. He's felt that empty void. He knows how much it hurts when someone you love dies. Jesus has felt the pain of a friendship gone bad. On that night when he was betrayed by Judas and arrested, that was a night when he needed his friends, his disciples, to be there and to support him the most. But what did they do? They ran and they hid. Even Peter, one of Jesus' closest companions, denied knowing him three times that night. Jesus suffered the physical pains of being beaten and crucified. It was his human nature that felt that whip tear the flesh from his back. It was his human nature that felt the pain of those nails being driven into his hands and his feet. It was his human nature that cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And then he died. Because Jesus is human, he understands exactly the trials and the tribulations that you're facing. He can relate to your pain, and he knows exactly how you feel. And he wants to do something about it. And now because Jesus is fully God, he has the power to do something about it. And the proof that Jesus is God, the proof that he can do something in your life to make some improvements, to make some changes, to give you hope, the proof that Jesus can heal your pain rests in the empty tomb. You see, anyone can die. In fact, one day we're all going to die, but only God can raise himself from the dead and come back to life. And that's exactly what Jesus did. Now, in our gospel reading this morning, We read how Jesus proved that he was alive, how he had defeated death and rose from the tomb. And how did he do that? Well, he appeared to people. He didn't hide himself. He walked out amongst them and he talked to them. He spent time with them. Now, if you've downloaded the bulletin for this morning's service, go ahead and turn to the gospel reading for today. If not, grab a Bible if you've got one close at hand and open it to the book of John. And we're going to look in the 20th chapter where our scripture reading is today. Now, beginning at verse 19 in John chapter 20, look again at what John writes. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. The wounds on Jesus' body confirmed his identity. There were fresh holes in his hands. There was a wound in his side from that spear. It was Jesus who was there amongst them. Now, I know it seems hard to believe. I mean, how many people do you know who have died and then come back to life 3 days later? Even Thomas, one of the 12, he had a hard time believing that Jesus was back from the dead. That's why he's been known ever since as Doubting Thomas. But look at what happened, beginning at verse 26. 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." But it doesn't stop there. We read in the book of Acts that Jesus continuously appeared to them over a period of 40 days. He even at one time sat down and ate a meal of fish with them, and that's told in John 21. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul writes that he appeared to Peter and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers at the same time. Jesus was everywhere. He proved that he was God. And as God, he had the power to heal. He has the power to stop pain. He has the power to give your life purpose. He has the power to forgive. And most importantly, he has the power to love you. Perhaps one of the greatest attributes of Jesus is that he has compassion. Jesus has a love for you that's beyond comprehension. He said, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." He's willing to have us cry out to him with all of our problems, with everything that we're suffering from, and he says that he will be there. "Ask, and it will be given to you," he said. So we need to come to Jesus in prayer with all of our needs, and we need to have faith that he'll answer those prayers. The problem, though, is that we don't often wait and listen for his answer. We just don't like the answer that he gives. You see, sometimes the answer to our prayers is yes. Sometimes the answer is no. And at other times the answer is not yet. You see, we have to allow Jesus to answer our prayers according to his will, not by just what we want. Jesus gives us the perfect example of how to pray in the Lord's Prayer. He gives us the example of how to pray as he demonstrates his prayer life over and over again, spending hours at a time praying to God the Father. Jesus took prayer seriously, and he understood the ways in which God answers prayer. But when Jesus prayed, he always asked that God's will be done, first and foremost. In the Garden of Gethsemane, on the night when Jesus was arrested, he prayed to his Father. And he prayed, "My Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." That's the example that Jesus has given to us. We need to pray. We need to come to God with all of the things that we're suffering from, all of our issues and our problems. Also, bring him all of our celebrations, all of our joys. Bring them all to God. We secondly need to believe that he will hear those prayers and he will answer those prayers according to his will. And finally, third, we need to receive whatever it is that God will give us when we pray to him. Music is a very powerful way to communicate. Every week here at Redeemer, we sing hymns and we sing other contemporary Christian songs. We sing these during our worship in the beginning, throughout the worship, and even at the end. And as we sing those songs, the words that we sing teach us about God's love. Those words reinforce and sustain our faith. Those words that we sing give thanks to God for all that he's done for us. Well, there's a song that we've sung many times over the years, and it's written by a band called Third Day. The song is called Cry Out to Jesus. The song talks about people who are struggling through life, people who are dealing with the effects of sin, people like all of us. And when life seems overwhelming, when life seems to be spiraling out of control, when you're filled with grief or anger or guilt, whenever the closeness to or the excitement about Jesus just isn't there like it was on Easter or on Christmas, then listen to the words of that song and let them guide you and comfort you. That song goes like this. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, and love for the broken hearts. There is grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing. He'll meet you wherever you are. Cry out to Jesus. And that's exactly what we need to do, especially in the times that we're facing right now. We need to cry out to Jesus, and then we need to receive all that he promises us. And all this is possible because he is risen. He is risen! He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite you to join me as we now confess our faith as we repeat the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This morning, as we pray together the prayer of the church, I'll end each of our petitions with the words, Lord, in your mercy, and I invite you to respond with Hear Our Prayer. Hear us, merciful Father, as we pray for ourselves, for the church, for our nation, and for all conditions and manners of people. God of mercy, keep us from the doubts and fears that cripple us and prevent us from knowing the fullness of your saving peace and gracious presence. Teach us to trust in your word and to believe with all our hearts, minds, bodies, and strength in Jesus Christ, crucified for our sins and raised for our justification. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of power, give courage and strength to those persecuted for the faith and comfort the families of the martyrs. Keep your church from following the winds of change. Make her steadfast in the doctrine of the apostles and the faith once delivered to the saints. Help us to admonish those who have fallen away with your word, and to restore with gentleness those who have wandered from the truth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of might, counsel the nations and their leaders in the paths of peace and justice. Bless us with wise, faithful, and just leaders who protect the sanctity of life and defend us against all enemies, foreign and domestic. Make us wise and discerning citizens who use the gift of liberty for noble purpose. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of love, teach us to love one another as you have loved us. Guide us so that in our neighborhoods and our communities we may manifest the love of Christ as well as his strength. Deliver us from all that would threaten our homes and families. Protect police, firefighters, disaster relief workers, and medical personnel who attend to us, as well as the places where we live and work. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of comfort, give your aid and relief to all who suffer want or need, to the sick and their afflictions, to those troubled in mind, and to those to whom death draws near. Hear us as we pray for those we bring to you in these petitions. Lord God, we pray for Karen, who's struggling with some heart-related issues. We pray you lay your healing hands upon her. For Raul, and for Sandy, and for Kevin, all facing serious health issues. Lord, we pray that you would just heal them now, that you would free them from the tough times that they're facing. We pray for Doug as he continues to fight this cancer in his body. Lord, bless him and heal him. Lord, we pray for the family of Clifford who died yesterday. Lord, give them comfort. Give them your peace during this time. Let them understand that those who die in faith are gathered into your arms and freed from the sin and all the effects it has on us in this earthly life. We pray for a daughter to repent and to turn back to you. We also pray for parents and their salvation. And on this day, Lord, we not only bring you all of the frustrations of life, we bring you celebrations as well. We ask for your blessings upon Leslie as she celebrates another birthday today. Lord, may it be a joyous day considering all the difficulties that we face right now, but may it be a day in which her family thanks you, Lord, for the gift that she has been to them and that you continue to bless her. But Lord, we do look at the world we live in right now, all of the challenges and frustrations because of the coronavirus. And so, Lord, we ask for you to intervene. We know that you and you alone is the one who can bring this pandemic to an end. Be with those who are infected. Comfort those who are hospitalized. May your presence be amongst the grieving families of those who have been called out. Lord, be with us and bring this to an end. And through this all, may this be our opportunity to turn back to you, to realize you're the God who loves us and sustains us. You're the God who can get us through any and all difficult times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of compassion, bless us with the good gifts of the earth, with the fruits of our honest labors, and with a kind and generous heart. Accept the worship of our hearts and voices along with the tithes and offerings we bring as part of our gratitude and thanksgiving. Open our eyes and our hearts to the needs of the poor so that we may serve them in your name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O blessed God and Lord, hear the prayers of your people and teach us to trust in your will, to answer our prayers with all that is needful and beneficial, both for us and for all for whom we have prayed. And hear us now, Lord, as we pray as you yourself have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. I pray that you and your families are safe and healthy during this time, that if you have any need that you reach out to this church, or if there's another church closer to you, maybe where you live, because I know we have people from around the country that are tuning into us, that you reach out, that you ask that staff there, that pastor there to pray for you and to help you in your needs. But as you are able, I pray that you're also able to reach out and share God's love with other people. Let him work through you. Be his hands and feet during this time. This is the perfect time to get out your phone book on a Sunday afternoon. Start at the A's and work your way through the Z's and just call people. People you haven't talked to in a long time. Tell them you're thinking about them and that you miss them and that you love them. This is our opportunity to let the light of Christ shine forth from all of us. Each day, I pray that you continue to check in on our website. We do have our daily devotions. Our prayer request line is open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And we're in the development right now of an online Bible study that will be coming very soon, that at any time you'll be able to check in each week and go through chapter and verse of a book of the Bible, learn exactly what God says, what God provides, and how he works in your life today through the very words that he has given to us. God bless each and every one of you, and I so look forward to that day when we can gather together again here in God's house to worship him and to celebrate that Jesus is risen. God bless you all. Would you join me now as we sing our closing hymn this morning, O Sons and Daughters of the King.